Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2021. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure that their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take item 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 will be the opportunity for members to reflect on the evidence they have heard earlier in the meeting, while item 4 will be consideration of a draft of the committee's pre-budget correspondence to the Scottish Government. Do members agree to take items 3 and 4 in private? Okay, great. Agenda item 2 is an opportunity for the committee to take evidence on evidence to inform its scrutiny of the valuation and rating Coronavirus Scotland Order 2021. This is the first of three sessions the committee will be holding on the order. And I'd like to begin by welcoming Mark Crothall, Chief Executive of the Scottish Tourism Alliance, Stuart McKinnon, Head of Communications and Public Affairs from the Federation of Small Businesses, Leon Thompson, Executive Director of UK Hospitality, Paul Togneri, Senior Policy Manager from Scottish Beer and Pub Association, and Colin Wilkinson, Managing Director from the Scottish Licensed Trade Association. Before I invite questions from members, can I ask that those participating in the session remotely press R in BlueJeans chat function if they wish to respond to a question. The BlueJeans chat function should not be used to write responses or questions as this will not be recorded. And just to say that my colleague Jenny here will help me keep track of the R function there. So I'd like to start with inviting questions from members. And I think, Paul, you wanted to take lead on the first theme.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. And can I, first of all, welcome the panel. Thanks to yourself and refer everyone to my register of interests. I'm an existing councillor in East Lothian Council. Good morning, panel. Good to see you this morning. I want to look at the first lot of questions. And the first question is whether witnesses agree with the Scottish Government that the coronavirus pandemic has affected the valuation of such a wide range of properties and business activities that it is more appropriate to take account of these effects at the next revaluation date. And can I ask Stuart McKinnon to answer that, possibly then followed up by Mark and then open it up to the panel. But Stuart, probably yourself, first of all.
Great. No problem. Thanks a lot, Paul. The evidence that we've gathered from our members suggests that 7 in 10 of our rent-paying members have paid rent as normal throughout this crisis. And although that we're concerned about that such a small share of our members managed to win concessions from our landlords, it suggests to us that the bulk of our rent-paying members certainly are facing similar conditions as they did before the crisis began. I think that when we look at this particular proposal from the government, we would highlight that the reliefs which the Scottish Government brought in have been far more important to our members and will continue to be more important to our members than opportunities to appeal their valuation.
Mark, yourself, and then I'll open up to anybody else who wants to come into the discussion.
Thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. I would echo a lot of what Stuart has just said. I mean, it's obviously well documented the impacts that have been the sector, and that's pan sector, has felt over the last 2 years as a result of coronavirus. And notwithstanding that, I don't think there's any part of the industry that hasn't been affected, and many, if not the majority, have all traded below where they would want to be trading at a level of profitability to be able to both reinvest in their asset, their people, and importantly to stay competitive as we come through recovery, and also repay the levels of debt that they've taken on. The Scottish Tourism Alliance is the overarching sort of umbrella body for the sector, and it's great to have colleagues from the hospitality and licensed trade on the call here today who can articulate very well how their own member groups have been affected by this. It swings and roundabouts. Some parts of the sector have done better than others, but there has without question been a lack of revenue, and there remains real concern going forward that unless a form of relief is continued as to how these businesses may adapt and change and get themselves into a position where they can be competitive and importantly invest in people and their asset, and also adapt as well to some of the net zero agenda challenges that are in front of them. So the reliefs of the last 2 years, business rates, without question, in my view, from our members, as saying, has been the most welcomed relief. And you know, we would have advocated that level of relief needs to continue beyond and the revaluation of the properties once we get to a trading period that is more reflective of what that likely position will be is the one that should be set. International recovery is by no means a cert, and certainly the trading period in the front in the next few months ahead of us are also going to be very, very difficult. So we would certainly support the view that the tone date that is set is one that is much more reflective to the trading performance going forward. And as Stuart said, for the majority, I would anticipate the preference would be for continued relief as to opposed to challenge some of the appeals that are in play at the moment.
Thank you for that. And we've got actually Leon, Paul, and then Colin would like to come in on this. So, Leon.
Good. Thank you very much, convener. Good morning, committee. Thank you for the opportunity to present to you today. I mean, in answer to the question, Paul, I mean, I think what I would say is that, you know, to echo Mark's comments, hospitality has been one of the hardest hit sectors during the pandemic. It's been hospitality businesses have largely been closed or unable to trade fully for the last 18, 19 months, and that's obviously put an incredible strain on those businesses that have racked up short-term and long-term debt throughout that period. The rates relief that the Scottish Government has applied for 2 years is incredibly welcome, and that's absolutely the kind of key element of the conversation right now around business rates. As Mark was explaining, sort of what happens next is absolutely critical in terms of the potential for relief to continue in some form, which I think is going to be absolutely critical for businesses if we want to avoid that kind of cliff edge next April. So I think that's probably what businesses are mostly focusing on rather than necessarily sort of appeals just now. I mean, I suppose what I would say though is that you know, removing the right to appeal does seem to go against the practice of having a sort of fair and transparent taxation system though. But I mean, probably right now that's not the key concern for our members or for the majority of hospitality businesses who will be very much focused on what happens after April 22 and then of course April 23 at the revaluation date as well, when, you know, really what we need to be moving to at that point is a system which more accurately reflects the business and the profits being made by hospitality businesses. Thanks.
Thank you. And Paul, and then Colin.
Yep. Thank you very much, convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting us along today. I'd 100% agree with the comments of my colleagues. The two-year relief has been instrumental and vital in keeping some hospitality businesses afloat and keeping them trading to this point. With that being said, though, we have lost an estimated 400 pubs in Scotland since the start of the pandemic. That's roughly 10%. And during the year 2020, we estimate that around 12 billion has been lost in revenue for the sector. So whilst it has been absolutely instrumental, that relief for the last 2 years, as colleagues have already said, it will be vital as well going forward that some of that is maintained to support businesses as we go forward. But would 100% agree with colleagues looking ahead to the next revaluation as well, that would be the preference. But yeah, absolutely, we just share the comments of colleagues.
Thank you. And Colin.
Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity to speak to you. Yes, I agree entirely with the comments that have been made by my colleagues. I do have to say, you know, the whole issue of commercial rates has been a very contentious one for many years within the industry, particularly because we proportionately pay a far greater percentage of our turnover in rates than any other business sector. So it is going forward that we're really looking at the moment. Yes, we need continuing relief, but we really need to have an overall review of commercial rates, particularly for our sector, because we can't carry on like this. Businesses are on a precipice just now. As Paul said, we've lost about 400 pubs in Scotland, and we're not out of this yet, and we are very concerned that figure will increase.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Yes, and thank you for that. Just to slightly expand on that, a few people obviously mentioned about the appeals, and I just want to ask a question about the material change of circumstances appeals. Are they an appropriate route for specific factors affecting individual properties or a limited number of properties? I think, Leon, you slightly touched on that and maybe open up with yourself, but just to get your thoughts specifically on that issue.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think the issue there is really that certainly for some businesses, they will be caught by this, and that, they may well feel that they're being sort of unfairly, they're being disadvantaged by not being able to appeal. I think for the bulk of businesses, though, I mean, the focus is very much on sort of what happens next. I mean, as I said, I think closing down the opportunity to appeal, does go against having an open taxation policy. I think that's something which needs to be kind of borne in mind here. We don't want to set any kind of precedent here where the goalposts can be moved. We need this to be as transparent as possible for businesses, and to give businesses who are and who feel that their circumstances have changed and that they haven't had the necessary support and recompense thus far, that they do have somewhere to go if they do want to appeal.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. We're going to move on in theme to parliamentary process, and I want to invite Megan Gallagher to lead on that.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Before I go into questions, like Paul, I am an existing councillor in North Lanarkshire, and therefore would like to refer everyone to my register of interests. As the convener said, I would like to discuss themes surrounding the parliamentary process, and in particular in relation to the consultation process. And I would like to ask the panel whether they believe that there was sufficient consultation on the proposals, and if they had an opportunity to comment on the planned changes, especially during COVID-19 and the challenges that has brought. And if I could start with Leon, please, and then Stuart.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the question. Has there been sufficient opportunity to engage in the process? I don't think that there has, and I think as for businesses, it's probably come as a bit of a surprise. I mean, obviously, there has been sort of movement at Westminster on this, so obviously we're kind of moving into line, I suppose, with Westminster. So there is a precedent there already. But I mean, to answer the question, for me, this has been my first opportunity to actually engage with Parliament, and simply with the Scottish Government. This has been the first opportunity to get a point of view out on this move.
Thank you. And Stuart, please.
Thank you. At the FSB, we're in fairly regular discussion with officials and race officials specifically. While we've not discussed particular move, we have discussed the wider rates landscape. At the point of the UK government making a similar decision to prevent MCC appeals, there was some discussion with officials about the implications of that change.
Okay, thank you. And Paul has indicated that he'd like to come in on this.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. It was just to echo the comments of colleagues again. As Leon said, this is really the first consultation which we are formally having on the issue. But I would say that we have almost daily dialogue with the Scottish Government, and the focus has really been business survival at this point, getting through the pandemic. And that's really been where the focus of ourselves and our conversations with government, but I think also where the businesses themselves have been. It's well known the impact on the sector, but this is the first real opportunity that we're having to directly engage on this issue.
Just because we're exploring that theme, if I could therefore maybe ask Leon and Paul to come back in to advise if they believe that there had been more of an opportunity for stakeholders to feed in views, if all changes had been introduced via primary legislation, if you think that would have been made a beneficial change.
Yes, I think that I think that certainly helps. I'm not sure I've really got much more to add on that. I mean, I think as Paul was saying, I think we've probably spent a lot of time sort of managing the immediate issues that have been affecting businesses, and this is just not really been on the radar.
And Paul, and then Mark.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I would agree with Leon on that. I mean, I think primary legislation always gives a greater opportunity for scrutiny, for engagement, for those that impact. So, however, as Leon says, the focus of the sector at the moment has really been on the pandemic, on restrictions, and making sure that we can get through to the other side of that, really.
Mark?
Yeah.
Yes, I think just coming back in general, the Scottish Tourism Emergency Response Group, STURG, which convenes fortnightly now, convened pretty much every week, along with the sector groups as well. You know, as my colleagues have said, the focus has been very much on the here and now and the recovery in the short to immediate term, and the recommendations that the Tourism Task Force have now tabled with Scottish Government to go through the sort of second phase of recovery, again, doesn't look at much else in the rate system other than the need for a form of continued rates relief for reasons that have already been stated, with the cliff edge of potential rise in VAT, obviously incremental costs as well, and the likely return to trading. Like others, this is the first sort of formal engagement that I've had on this particular issue.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to move on to the theme of workload issues, and I'm going to pick up on that. So the 40,000 plus COVID-related MCC appeals are facing assessors and valuation committees at a time when they have limited capacity for the processing of appeals. Due to the pandemic, a smaller proportion of appeals have been resolved at this stage in the re-evaluation cycle compared to the last cycle. While assessors try to catch up, they are also needing to spend time on the initial stages of the next valuation, which is due in 2023. If they were to grant many of the COVID-related MCC appeals, this would likely lead to further appeals being lodged, and successful appeals would need to be regularly reviewed as the COVID legislation and guidance changes. So given all of that, is it feasible for assessors and valuation committees to assess coronavirus-related MCC appeals with the time and resources that they currently have? And I'd like to direct that to Colin and then Stuart.
Yes, I think, as we said earlier, the appeals for COVID is kind of at the back of people's minds. It's what's going to happen going forward, and I think it's very important that we get the revaluation right. It's very important to businesses ongoing. As I've said, it's a contentious issue, the rating system. There needs to be some kind of reform or ongoing relief. Now, whether that's in the form of a further support from the government financially, or do we look at, which is in the powers of the government, perhaps looking at a system whereby We have a varied poundage rate, particularly for sectors such as ours that have been, we would argue, hit the hardest over this last 18 months, 2 years. But I think that's the main thing, to be honest, is what's going to happen going forward. And I would just add it again that I agree with my colleagues what they said to the previous question. We've had no opportunity to discuss this matter.
Thank you. And Stuart?
Thank you. I'll talk specifically about, sorry, I'll talk about the appeal system generally and then come to the issue that you mentioned specifically. So the evidence that we've gathered suggests that the non-domestic rates appeal system does not work particularly well for Scotland's small businesses after the last revaluation, sorry, the revaluation before last, fifth of our members chose to appeal, only a fifth. And the bulk of them chose to represent themselves, and anecdotes suggest that businesses that represent themselves through that system tend to be unsuccessful, broadly because they're not arguing whether their valuations are unfair. The challenge is to argue that they're inaccurate. Right at this point, as we look towards the next revaluation and the Barclay Review reforms that are in the pipeline, we need to realise that if we're going to deliver a more frequent revaluation cycle, policymakers have recognised that they need to dramatically reduce the number of appeals that are in the system. And with many of the Barclay reviews yet to be implemented, I can understand why the Scottish Government might arrive at the conclusion that mid-cycle or MCC appeals are not appropriate at this time. I would, however, argue that one way to reduce the number of MCC appeals in the pipeline at this moment would be to provide details of reliefs that are going to come in place after April of next year.
Thank you for that. And anybody else want to come in on that question about workload or processing appeals? No? Okay. I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is we're going to be looking at local authority revenue, and Miles is going to pick that up.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to touch upon a few questions with regards to what local government can also do to support yourselves, but in terms of effective use of resources, in the programme for government, Scottish Government stated that rolling out COVID-19 appeals will ensure that the limited public resources that are available are effectively targeted to support the most effective businesses and sectors in the recovery period. Now, beyond MCC, I was wondering what the panel thought local authorities could also be doing to support you so we can harvest that sort of information today as well. I'll maybe start with Colin, because I know you touched upon poundage rate earlier, then Stuart.
Yes.
Colin, yes.
Yeah, sorry. Yes, I mean, any assistance is gratefully welcomed. I mean, you know, the problem we have is particularly with Scottish assessors and the way that they value licensed premises. That's always been the big issue that we have. As I said, you know, we're looking at about 8.25%, 8.5% of our turnover. So I think if there's more assistance from local authorities and through the assessors, to look at licensed premises. But I go back to, we do have to have an overhaul of the rating system. Now, I know we've had that through the Barclay Review, but that did recognise that there was still a problem for the licensed hospitality trade. And that's something that we'd hope you know, local councils would get on board with us, because we're a very important industry. If you look at the state our high streets are in at the moment, in many places, it could be the hospitality industry as sort of the key player in these situations. So we do need as much help as we possibly can get.
Thank you, Colin. And Stuart?
I think, you know, throughout this crisis, local authorities have had a key role in supporting their local economies and their local businesses. You know, many councils and many, specifically the non-domestic rates teams within their councils, worked extremely hard to distribute grants to businesses. And while in some cases we would like to have seen that money move more quickly, I think much of the business community should extend their thanks to these council workers who did such a good job in difficult circumstances. You know, one of the key advantage of a relief and a national relief is that it's paid by for central government, and that's one of the advantages over an appeals-based route for businesses to reduce their overheads as we enter this recovery period. What we have seen are many local authorities in Scotland offer new grant support for businesses into the recovery phase, which we support. We've seen many local authorities offering grant support for businesses to, say, expand their digital capabilities. We're very supportive of that as well. One thing that I would highlight is that local authorities and council, local authorities across Scotland, have the power to introduce local reliefs. We tend not to see those powers used very often. And there's maybe an opportunity for local authorities, perhaps in partnership with the Scottish Government, to look at whether this is the time to provide more localised reliefs, perhaps in our city centres that look like who seem to be facing persistent problems as a consequence of the changing in working and living habits as a consequence of the coronavirus pandemic.
Thank you, and Leon.
Very supportive of the comments that Stuart's just made there, and I think, you know, a key point in this is partnership. And throughout the pandemic, you know, local authorities and the teams within local authorities have worked incredibly well with businesses. And I think what we really want to do is to sort of look at how we keep those partnerships going, because hospitality businesses are absolutely at the heart of community, at the heart of place. I think that, you know, we do need to kind of keep those strong relationships going as we move forward.
Thank you, Leon, and then Paul, and followed by Mark.
Yeah, thank you very much, Peter. Yeah, absolutely echo the comments from our colleagues on that. The support has been coming from local authorities via from central government via local authorities or from local authorities directly has been instrumental in keeping those businesses afloat. In terms of what extra things can be done, it's really looking at, I think, our high streets, our communities in the whole, and seeing what can be done to support that. Every pub contributes around about £100,000 into the local economy. So it is very instrumental, as others have said, in being at sort of the heart of those communities. But there's a range of reliefs which could and can be done to support the hospitality sector. For example, we've seen a lot of the waiving of fees for outdoor tables or tables on pavements, which is hugely costly in normal terms. So the removal of those fees has been extremely helpful. Of course, whilst we're trying to encourage people to be outside as well, that has been helpful. But we've seen other instances across Scotland of local authorities acting to support their local communities and high streets, and any reliefs that we get, as others have said, is absolutely instrumental in keeping us afloat, and we're very, very grateful to the local authorities for doing that, and the council workers who have been fantastic at getting those grants processed. As others have said, sometimes it would have ideally liked it to be a little bit quicker, but by and large, the work that they have done has been absolutely instrumental.
Thank you, Paul. And Mark?
Yes, thank you. I would echo everything that everybody said about the local authority support. Hugh Lightbody, representing COSLA, sits on the Scottish Tourism Emergency Response Group and has been a huge contributor to everything that group has done over the course of the pandemic. Scotland Outlook 2030, which is our national tourism strategy, launched by the First Minister only 3 days before COVID actually took grip, is still a very relevant strategy. And we have been working with the recommendations of Through Recovery very much to align our focus into the priority areas for that strategy. And those four key priority areas are around people, business, place and experience. So the importance of local community and bringing communities with us in rebuilding tourism and actually also spreading tourism around the country so the benefits of the sector can be felt by all communities is key. The conditions for success, of course, are very much required to be having the right policy, the right investment into infrastructure, the right support in upskilling our people. So the digital boost programs that was referred to by Stuart, just being some of those. With the broader issue of having more affordable housing, but also recognising, I think, in all of their local agendas of just how important tourism is to driving the recovery to those local communities. But it, equally important to that is supporting the supply chains as well. So the support local campaign that Scottish Towns and City initiated is one that we very much endorse, and you know, encouraging businesses to be more diversified in their product offering is also key. And Paul touched on the now very clear, able ability for us to enjoy alfresco dining in Scotland 24/7 is something that I think we all need to continue to support, because businesses have invested a lot of money into being able to make themselves able to do that, and it would be wrong if they are suddenly penalised by a local authority if they can't build on that, particularly as our culture has become more used to eating outdoors as well as indoors in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
And thanks for that, Mark. And I think it can also help support our winter clothes industry as well, if we keep our alfresco dining going forward. That's all the questions I have from that section. I'll hopefully come in theme five, okay, if I can, convener.
Yeah, great. Okay, so we're going to move on to our fifth and final theme, which is other forms of business support. And I'm going to invite a colleague who's coming in hybrid on Blue Jeans, Willie Coffey, to start that theme.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I hope you can hear me okay. I've had to switch devices during this session to be able to connect with you. I wanted to ask your views on whether you think the MCC process in general gives us the most effective mechanism to target the support that's needed. We just heard from Stuart a wee moment ago that I think he said that only a fifth of small businesses generally appeal their valuations and so on. And I'm aware that the UK government announced back in March a £1.5 billion support relief scheme that they say will enable local government to properly target those small businesses and businesses that perhaps need support most. I don't think that money has been made available yet, but could I just ask for views on whether that kind of approach would seem to be a better one rather than having a broader MCC appeal process? And maybe Stuart could start and answer that one, please.
Thank you. I would absolutely agree with the UK government and the Welsh government as well when they said that a relief package was the best means of getting rate support to businesses, many of whom will not have been able to use their property for large chunks of the crisis. And so asking them for property taxes while these businesses for property taxes while they can't effectively use the properties, a relief seems appropriate at that time, whereas an appeals process is obviously only open to the businesses that lodge the appeals. And what you tend to find, not across the board, but what you tend to find is that it's larger organisations that that tend to use property professionals and others to argue these particular cases. And the other key point in this mix is about pace of delivery. One thing is that a relief can be implemented fairly quickly, but an MCC appeal and the wider appeal system tends to move quite slowly. And that actually that's another key advantage for a relief over an appeals route to reduce bills for businesses.
Thank you for that, Stuart. Other panel members, could you offer a view on that point as well, please?
I think just echoing and building on what Stuart said, I think looking at what businesses being asked to do and need to do and want to do in terms of in investing in their asset, in their people, And obviously applying the adaptations in many cases to become more sustainable and aligned to the challenges of the net zero targets that we're all striving to achieve. They need to have a clear signal of relief being off their balance sheet sooner rather than later to make those commitments. We've not only seen, obviously, you know, rising costs in energy and the supply chain in general, businesses, many businesses have been in the sector paying way in excess of the minimum wage to attract talent in as well, and they want to be able to sustain that. But if there was an uncertainty around any future relief or a different approach to that relief being afforded, then I would fear that many will not be able to both be competitive, employ the level of people that the sector can actually go ahead and employ to help recover. But importantly, we need to invest in those new people because we don't, unfortunately, have enough people in the pool of population. So that will take time. And this cliff edge, as we've all referred to, I think, on this call so far, is still looming. And the sooner the indication is given by Scottish Government on what that relief might look like going forward, and likewise, hopefully, the UK Government on the current level of VAT being maintained beyond the end of March next year, the better, and more confidence will that give to industry as well.
Thank you. And Leon.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Yes. Definitely. Relief system is going to be better, fairer, and more targeted than the current appeals system, and the figures that that Stuart has shared with the committee bear that out. I think what this also demonstrates is that there's fundamental flaws in the in business rate system at the moment, with so many, you know, with businesses choosing to go down that larger businesses choosing to go down that appeals route. So that does suggest that, you know, we really are at a point where we need to be looking at business rates fully, and actually looking at a fairer system for all businesses, seeing more businesses paying their share than perhaps they are at the moment, and lifting the burden from hospitality and businesses. On the point about money which Westminster is making available, I understand that there are consequentials for Scotland coming up to about 145 million. So it would certainly be good to hear, you know, how that money will be used in a form of relief in due course by the Scottish Government. Thanks.
Thanks, Leon.
Thank you, and Paul.
Yes, as others have said, absolutely, the preference would be for the relief system for the reasons outlined by my colleagues, in terms of surety, in terms of the time it would take, but also just to highlight the wider economic issues that the sector is still facing. We have real concerns about inflationary costs at the moment. The costs of electricity and gas is well documented, but of course businesses have no cap like domestic properties, so that's another concern for us. But similarly, the impact on staff was something which was alive to us and of concern even before the pandemic. Brexit has had a real impact on our staffing levels, but similarly, moving forward, the pandemic has also had a real impact. So we're still suffering an acute shortage there. So being able to invest in employees by bringing new people on board and supporting those current employees. And as Mark has said, we've had a lot of increased pay as a result, trying to attract people into these industries as well. So absolutely, any further relief and the sooner that can be released and revealed, the better for the sector.
Thank you. And Mark wants to come in on that as well.
Yeah, just a couple of other points. I mean, again, businesses are reporting, you know, suppliers to industry are now also increasingly looking for an amount of money to be lodged on deposit. So therefore, obviously, the cash flow has been cut back. An example, Worldpay, which is one of the transactional platforms that many of us would pay by through our card system. Port of Adding Marina as an example, had something like £250,000 worth of revenue had gone through that system. And then in August of this year, WorldPlay announced that they wanted to retain £100,000 of that revenue on credit, basically, so not released into the business. Other utility companies are also doing the same. So the ability for access to cash and to do what businesses need to do is obviously less, on top of the inflationary challenges that we all face as well. But, you know, from a national point of view, and again, the strategic aim of Scotland is to be the world leader in 21st century tourism. We are sort of starting a bit behind the curve when it comes to our competitors who are ahead of the game in terms of attracting international markets. And, you know, international inbound tourism is approximately 42% of the total revenue mix. And that won't return to the levels of 19 or even to the levels that we would expect them and want them to be for a good few months yet, if not into the back end of 2022 as well. So there's a lot of work to be done still. And, you know, that competitiveness piece is really important. And we need our businesses to be absolutely well invested in, our people importantly, you know, trained, recruited, and so we are capable of presenting the product that Scotland wants to present and the industry aspire to as well.
And Colin.
One thing to add, I fully agree with all my colleagues have said, but if it's to go down a system where there's rates, further rates relief, that should be targeted and focused on the businesses most in need, because there have been some businesses that have actually done very well through this COVID period. So I think it should be focused on those most in need.
Thank you for that. And sorry, Willie, did you want to pick up on anything?
No, just thank you very much to the panel for answering that question. Thank you.
Great, thank you. And I want to bring in Eleanor Whittam, who's also joining us virtually.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And before I ask my questions, I would just like to refer everybody to my register of interests. I'm still a serving councillor in East Ayrshire Council. My first question is quite a general question. We've heard about that really fantastic joint collaborative working that's happened between local government and the businesses in their local areas. But just in general, how effective do you think that the support for businesses has been targeted in response to the pandemic? And that, you know, is both spheres of government. So whether that's UK national government, Scottish Government, or indeed local government, which we've heard quite a lot about so far. And if I can perhaps direct that to Stuart to start with, please.
Thank you. Throughout the crisis, we saw decision makers be quite clear that there was no way that they could fully compensate businesses for the lost income that they would face as a consequence of some of these public health measures. So, for example, the grants regime that was delivered in Scotland, the £10,000 and £25,000 grants, the CabSec for Finance was quite clear that that wasn't meant to fully compensate businesses for their lost revenue, but it was to help mitigate the immediate pressures that businesses were facing. Anecdotally, we know that many businesses exhaust their cash reserves. We know that Scottish businesses took on about £4 billion worth of debt through the CBILS and BBILS government-backed loan schemes alone. So it's obvious there that businesses hadn't had to borrow because the other mechanisms to support them weren't sufficient. I would accept that there was a need to get for money to reach businesses quickly, and for the sake of pace, some elements of targeting were lost. And I think that we would, if we look at a lot of the economic data produced by people like the Bank of England and others, it looks like the burden of the crisis in economic terms was felt disproportionately by small and medium-sized businesses as opposed to their their larger counterparts. And that's why we are arguing, as we enter into the recovery phase, government at all levels should really be focusing on helping small and medium-sized firms who support every second private sector job in the country get back on their feet simply because we don't think that local communities will recover until their local business communities are firing on all cylinders. Looking to the future, obviously we're talking about rates today, and we're seeing additional support specifically for small businesses outside of the scope of the small business bonus in the next financial year might be necessary. What we would also say is that as governments make tax and spending decisions, we need to give local and independent businesses time to recover, to pay down their debts, to grapple with the challenge of, say, rising energy bills and another rising overheads, as colleagues have spoken to, and not clobber them with tax rises. And so there is some concerns, as we see, for instance, the increase in NICs, that will have a disproportionate impact on small businesses. And that's why, for instance, we're looking for the Chancellor to announce an expansion to the employment allowance when he stands up tomorrow.
Thank you for that. And I think Paul wants to come in on this too.
I agree with the points that Stuart made there. As he said, I think the Cabinet Secretary was quite clear at the start of the process that the idea was to allow a bridge to the other side of the crisis for the majority of businesses. And I think the grants have, by and large, delivered that. As I mentioned earlier, we have lost 400 pubs since the start of the pandemic, but without the economic support, it would have been much, much more than that. I think whilst it has been very, very positive, it's not been perfect in every instance. I think in the first round of grants, businesses with a rateable value of above 51,000 did not receive any economic support. Those businesses had the same, they would have a proportionate share of costs, more staff to support, and again, most likely larger bills to pay. So that was something of concern for us pretty much at the beginning. I think that we've also saw later on in the pandemic that the support perhaps didn't quite line up with the restrictions. I'm thinking in particular, for example, when pubs could not serve alcohol or open late in the evening, I believe they were entitled to the same grant support as those who would be more traditionally be seen as a cafe, for example. But then later on, I think the third round of grants, there was additional support for those over 51k. There was a lot of engagement with the sector. Ourselves on the call and other colleagues were very closely engaged with government on that. So whilst I think it wasn't perfect and there was definitely inconsistencies in the grant support, the key thing was that it moved quite quickly, and without that, it would have left more businesses unsure of their survival. And we would have seen a lot more businesses fail had it not been for that support. So again, not perfect, but by and large, absolutely vital in keeping a lot of these businesses alive and trading today.
Thank you, Paul. And then Mark and Leon want to come in too.
Thank you. I'd echo a lot of what's been said. And, you know, I think everybody was faced with what was a new situation to deal with, and having to change from their day-to-day job into doing something that was, new to them as well. So PACE was at times a challenge, but without the relief that's been provided, as Paul said, many would have failed. It was a very much, in some cases, a bit of learn as you go. But from a tourism perspective, I mean, I would like to sort of put on record. Hats off to colleagues at Visit Scotland, who in particular have managed a series of targeted sectoral funds to the inbound sector, the marine sector, the tour operators, the coach guys, everybody who's facilitated those grants have been absolutely exemplary in their efforts to try and move them as quickly as possible. And the grant criteria has always been one that is engaged with the industry to sort of shape what that criteria would be. But just picking up on Paul's points around perhaps not being able to acknowledge in a proportionate way where the impacts of a lockdown in a particular local authority area, if it was largely a central belt area, there was a direct knock-on impact into parts of the country where they were their customer base, and any sort of relief being able to be afforded to those in the more rural parts, and many of those businesses were small businesses as well, they were unable to access support because it wasn't joined up. But none of it's in any way compensated for the loss of revenues, as we all know would be the case. But we continue to make the case for key sectors that will need targeted support as well, and how we can, quicken the delivery mechanism of that fund to allow those businesses to trade in a constructive and positive way to recover. And I think many would say that we're still not in that recovery piece yet. We're still very, very much in a survival mode. We've obviously had the additional £25 million that was announced by the First Minister back in March this year to support the initial 10 recommendations that the task force put forward to help drive recovery, and a lot of that's in train at the moment, and support as well from Skills Development Scotland to help recover and train our retain our existing workforce and upskill them too. So hats off to those that have done it. Obviously the learnings that we've all taken, I think, have been important, and if we do go again, hopefully it will be even more smoother than it has been in the more recent times than it was at the outset.
Thank you for that, Mark. And I realise there's a couple of other folks who want to come in on this, but in the interest of time, I think I'd like to just come back to Elena and see if you want to ask any more questions before we move to Miles.
Yeah, thanks, convener. And it's just a quick mop-up because the next question I had was actually answered in part by Stuart to my colleague Willie Coffey's question. But it's just to give the panel an opportunity to explore the fact that, do they feel that there's some businesses, perhaps larger businesses, as Stuart had mentioned, who are able to bring in those professional advisors to help them with an MCC appeals process, who, as Colin rightly pointed out, perhaps have benefited during the pandemic more than those small and medium sized enterprises who have perhaps been hit more. So it's just if the panel's got any final thoughts on that aspect, and how we can make sure that those small and medium sized businesses who perhaps couldn't avail themselves of the MCC appeals process, how can we ensure that they get the adequate and correct support going forward from this moment? And I'll maybe bring that back to Colin if he's got any thoughts on it, because he's the one that kind of mentioned it in the first place. Thanks.
Yes. I'm sure my colleagues also provide a service, but the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, we work with Gerald Eve, and we promote to our members a service whereby through that company they can put in an appeal for them. We've done that for a number of years, but getting the message out to them is always a difficulty, of course. But there is a service there that we provide, and I think our colleagues will as well, to advise members where they should or what they should do, and we make a recommendation that they speak to that company. So there is a system that we provide for our members.
Okay, thank you. And I'm going to move over to Miles, who's got some
thank
more
you,
questions.
Convener. It was more actually kind of on the back of Elena's question there, because I wanted to ask specifically, Paul, you had mentioned, I think, 400 pubs, 10% of the Scottish total, had failed during the pandemic. Now, we know that the rates relief is already in place through the small business bonus for up to £15,000. So these smaller businesses and smaller premises wouldn't necessarily benefit. So I wondered, in terms of your experience from the panel, of what sort of businesses have failed during the pandemic, and whether or not there's a collaboration between rateable value of these businesses. I'll maybe start with Paul, as I name checked you for the information.
Yeah, thanks very much, Miles. I don't think we have the sort of breakdown of that available to us yet. The 400 figure comes from CGA, so it's definitely got that professional backing, and we're positive, well, not positive, but we have faith in that figure. But it does not go into that sort of further detail I think anecdotally, we probably have seen some smaller businesses fail as a result, probably due to cash reserves issues that we've had there, and again, the ability for them to apply for grants to and to weather the storm, so to speak. So I don't think we necessarily have that sort of breakdown at the moment. I'm sure we will see further details come out and patterns emerge, but I don't think that's something that has a clear picture across the board yet. Colleagues may wish to come in and add their thoughts, but I don't think we have a clear picture at the moment where these businesses are failing. Of course, there's been different impacts in different areas, which some colleagues have touched on. So your city centre premises, with the loss of international visitors, with the loss of office trade, may be the ones which are again more impacted than your suburban premise or your more rural premise. Again, people wanting to get out and about into the countryside, or where just being at home, people have not been inside city centres as much. So it's quite likely that there may be an uptick there. But I think, as far as the sector is concerned, we're not out the woods yet in terms of the pandemic. We still have, of course, some restrictions in terms of the baseline measures on properties, and a post-COVID certification has came in and impacted some of these premises as well. So we're not quite out the woods yet. There may still be further business failures dependent on the economic situation going forward. I don't think there's a completely clear picture as of yet what type of businesses these are, that will hopefully emerge relatively soon.
Thanks, Paul. And then we're going to Stuart would like to come in, followed by Colin, and then Mark.
Thank you. Naturally, at the moment, larger licensed businesses are getting the retail, hospitality and leisure relief, and so there's no difference between them and recipients of the small business bonus, at least in rates terms. What I would highlight today is that naturally I'm on a panel with lots of representations of the hospitality and leisure industry. There's obviously a larger picture here as well. I would like just to speak to some of our other members' issues. Actually, over the course of the crisis, we saw many independent, non-essential businesses closed for large parts of the crisis, while their larger counterparts were allowed to keep trading. And we know that smaller businesses were less likely to have large cash reserves in comparison to the larger counterparts. So as we move into the next phase of the crisis, need to look at policy arrangements to help small and medium-sized businesses get back on their feet. However, I would also highlight that there are many small and medium-sized firms who operate from slightly more valuable premises outside of the small business bonus, and we would like the Scottish Government to explore mechanisms to get help to them if the current broad relief comes to an end in April of next year.
Thank you. And Colin?
Yes, it was just the mention of the small business bonus scheme there. Because of the way we are rated, many of what we would term as small licensed premises or medium-sized licensed premises don't actually qualify for that. And in many cases, they're paying the actual supplementary rate. So we're back to this issue on how we are rated does affect this.
Thank you for that. And Mark?
Yeah, just a couple of points, I suppose, around business failure in general. Obviously, Paul's touched on the impacts in the city. When you look at the loss of office trading and international, that has been hugely impactful. And some of the smaller sort of cafes and restaurants, you see they're locked, their doors are closed. It's just purely to demand levels as well not being there. And obviously workforce, and many of our properties right across the country in the sector are actually only trading at less than 100% capacity because of their inability to provide a service. You'll see more and more so now properties trading 5 days out of 7 or reduced menu offering, etc. And then there are some niche sectors as well, such as the golf tourism industry, again, have had no international visitors, so a lot of those guys have suffered too. But I think importantly, just picking up on Stuart's point around, there are others obviously in the small businesses who are absolutely essential to frontline hospitality in our sector being able to trade and that in the supply chain. And looking at the wedding sector, the Scottish Wedding Industry Alliance formed itself. There are a huge number of suppliers to that industry as well who have been supported by the government. But, you know, if we don't have a stable supply chain, it's very difficult to deliver the front end as well. So, you know, relief looking at the ecosystem of tourism and hospitality, I think is absolutely critical. And because we are, as we said earlier, you know, the lifeblood of many local community as well, whether that be the florist, the carpenter, or as well as obviously the workforce that can provide, you know, frontline services, and also to help address some of the mental health challenges as well that people have been facing. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Anybody else? Okay, well, so we've come to the end of our questions. And I just want to say thank you so much for all of you coming to give evidence. And it was interesting to hear that from some of your perspectives, this was the first time that you were able to get your points of view across. And so we really appreciate that. And now we are going to move on in our meeting into a private session.